easily the most asked question in math class is some variation of, when am I ever going to use this? Even though it's not always verbalized. When you Google this question, a majority of the autofill searches are math related. Some students may ask this as a challenge to the teacher, while others, they're sincere. In either case, teachers' responses are rarely satisfying. They may quip that they'll need it for their homework or the next exam, perhaps give a more thoughtful response by trying to tie the math they're learning to some field of employment or application the student might find interesting. This is typically the best the teacher can do, but if you've been in a class where this happens, you know it is rarely satisfying. This has become a paradox that I've spent a lot of time thinking about. We know math is useful. Billions of people are doing mathematics every day, and probably hundreds of millions are using ideas from secondary math or higher every day. And yet it's so difficult to convince most students that math is useful. In this series of videos, I'll do my best to address this paradox. But if you want more details, this video is actually based off an essay I wrote several years ago, and you can read the essay in its entirety using the link below. To start off thinking about this paradox, let's do a thought experiment. Take a moment and think about the last time you used multiplication outside of a school environment. It might be hard, but try to remember. Think. Do you have a situation yet? It doesn't have to be a time that you wrote down a multiplication problem or worked something out on paper. You could have done it in your head or on a calculator. If you were like me, you're having a hard time remembering a specific situation. And yet, I know I use multiplication all the time. It's become so ingrained in my thought process, I don't usually notice it anymore. And I bet that's true for most of you. This may be the first piece in understanding this paradox. Math is useful, but the large majority of its use is done mentally, and maybe even subconsciously. I call this insight, math is a part of you. So much a part of you that you don't notice it much. And when you use it, it probably doesn't look like the kind of math you did in school. So it's easy for many people to live their post-school lives thinking that they don't use or rarely use math. When in actuality, anytime they bump into something remotely quantitative, a graph, a formula, numbers in a news article, statistics on social media, etc., you drop on a myriad of mathematical connections made during the many hours spent in math classes to make meaning of what you are experiencing. Cognitive scientists might say that all those experiences in math class have helped you to develop a certain schema or model for dealing with quantitative information. And using that schema is so natural and looks so different from school math that you don't think you are using math. But try answering a student's, "When will I ever use this?" question with, "Well, you'll use it, but you won't realize that you're using it." Yeah, that's going to go over really well. What about giving students real problems where real people really used math? It shouldn't be hard for students to argue with that. Here are four recent examples when actual people used multiplication in their life. Calculating the area of a raspberry patch, quickly checking to see if I had 24 cans of soup at the store. When you have 8 kids, you buy in bulk. Estimating how many RBIs a favorite Major League Baseball player would have by the end of the season, and checking to see if the number of diapers on hand would last until the end of the month. But which of these contexts is going to make a fourth grader excited about their homework? Probably none. Many people think the way to get students excited about math is to connect the math to interest of the kids. But this can be difficult to do well and can easily backfire. If a student has been engaged in a hobby and hasn't had to do math, it's hard to convince them that they should learn math for that hobby. In fact, I would argue that application problems, especially textbook application problems, can do a lot more to convince students that math is not useful rather than the alternative. I saw this time and time again teaching college algebra as a graduate student. I would do what I thought was a decent job of teaching a new topic. Students would be nodding along, but as soon as I brought in an application of the topic, something from engineering or biology or something like that, I could see them saying to themselves, "I thought this would be useful to me, but if this is how it's used, now I know I will never use this." I call this the paradox of application. This becomes the second insight into this larger paradox we're trying to understand. Applications so often involve such specific contexts that most students don't feel the problem actually applies to them. This really puts math teachers in a bind. Application problems are often too specific and not applicable to enough students. But on the other hand, having no applications is worse and signals to students that math is never used in real life. Teachers, then, are forced to do the very hard work of finding or creating application problems that are general enough and compelling enough to interest all students. One of the problems that teachers face is that they're usually teaching just one new concept or technique, and it's really hard to find an interesting application problem that only uses the one concept or technique. Real-world problems use math from all over the curriculum and from different grades and classes. And one reason why textbook problems feel contrived is because they're sterilized and shoehorned into a problem where students only use the one technique the teacher wants them to practice. And on top of that, the question in the problem's not compelling for the students. So we end up with a powerful way to convince students that math is not useful. But there is a different approach to applied math. Math can be a powerful way to make sense of the world around us, not just important skills for those going into technical fields. To help people understand this face of mathematics, we should show people how math can answer compelling questions about everyday situations and use examples from specific technical fields sparingly. I have had better luck with these kind of problems in my math classes, and this is largely the approach we use in this channel. But this is hard for teachers because curriculum materials aren't written with these kind of problems readily available, and we don't have a great way for teachers to share good problems with others. The nature of real-world problems doesn't fit with practicing one concept or technique. This leads to a teaching dilemma. The more natural and compelling the question, the solutions will look less like school math and the harder for teachers to use to fit their goals of teaching specific content and ideas. If the math idea comes first, then adding a context often feels forced and unnatural. But if the question comes first, then using the math is natural, but it most definitely will involve more than just the specific math topic the teacher is trying to teach. For teachers, it takes some time and effort and skill to be able to use these problems in different ways to meet the goals of the course, and we're just learning how to do that well. Before we end, I will add that math is not just amazing because of what it can teach us about the world. There are plenty of amazing things about math itself. In my class, my goal is to blow my students' minds every day. Sometimes it's with a real-world problem, and sometimes it's something that exists purely inside the incredible world of mathematics. In part two of this series, we will talk about other ways to make sense of this paradox, including insights from Steve Jobs and the doctor that developed the first artificial lung. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.